So I'm Elaine Miller-Karas, and I'm the executive director of the Trauma Resource Institute,
My name is Susan Reedy, and I'm a marriage and family therapist and also a school consultant, and I bring the TRIM model into schools and into my private practice and work with parents on helping build their resilient kids as well.
And I'm one of the co-creators of the model that we're going to present. And actually, it was so perfect that Janina talked this morning, because she talked in a more academic way than what we're going to talk about. Because what we do is we bring the neuroscience that is so amazing right now, but we have created a clinical application of the neuroscience that we take and we train not only within the United States, but we train around the world. And one of the things that we've learned as we've gone around the world, like I just came back from the Philippines where I trained 40 people to be trainers in this model there, is that we are designed very elegantly in the very same way. So our nervous system responds, our body and our mind respond similarly to trauma, for example, to extraordinary life events, whether we live here or we live there. And there are similar ways to healing. And I also want encourage all of us to think about not only being trauma-informed, but be resiliency-informed. And I love the word resiliency, because I see it everywhere I go around the world. People say, Elaine, how can you go? You've been to the Philippines, you've been to China, you've been to Haiti. Because everywhere I go, I see the amazing capacity of the human spirit to be able to really live fully in the present moment. And that if we get knocked out of our resilient zone, which when we were talking with Janina, she talked about it being the window of tolerance. I find that that's a hard term for some people to understand. But many people understand resilient zone, or the flow zone, the kids call it. We have all of our materials translated in many languages, and so those of you that are Spanish speaking, la zona de bienestar. So we try to make things very culturally appropriate and also very understandable, because really our goal is to make this accessible. So we're not going to talk about some of the slides we had planned to talk about, because Janina already did, and we really want to get into the meat and potatoes of what we're talking about. And so as people stand up, we want to actually do something, a little game that I've played all over the world, and it's called the mimic game. Some of you may have done it. So I'm going to make a gesture, and then I'm going to point to someone and ask that person, and I'm going to make a gesture, and I'm going to invite all of you to do it with me. And then I'm going to point to someone, let's say like Laura, and I'm going to invite her to make a gesture, and then we're going to follow what the gesture is that she's making. So, and plus we've just had lunch, right? And what happens after lunch? I feel like sleeping usually. So this hopefully will enliven us a little bit. Okay, so should I start?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, well, I think I'll just do this. Woo! Make sure we have enough room around us. All right, look at this. Okay, so how about you? Candace.
Okay.
And point to someone else, Candace. Ooh, we've got styling going here. Look at that styling. All right. One more. Applause. All right. Thank you. So I'm going to invite you to sit. And I'm also going to teach you the very first skill of our model, which is called tracking. And actually, Janina mentioned something, the word notice. And we use that word too. Because what we have found has been an important ingredient to not only start to heal trauma, but to build resiliency, is to notice what's happening on the inside. So I'm just wondering, as we did our little exercise, did anybody notice that their heartbeat might be beating a little fast? Are you noticing? Laura and Peggy are, okay. Anybody else? Heartbeat fast? How about your breathing? Is it a little faster? Shallow? Okay. Does anybody feel any like tingling or warmth in their body? Mm-hmm. Warmth? Okay. Guess what?
How about a little bit of a smile?
Look at that.
Yeah.
All right. So that's tracking the autonomic nervous system. And what we've learned, and I'm going to just kind of go forward a little bit, because we've really already talked about this, is that we've learned that the responses to trauma and stress can have a major effect on the mind, body, and spirit, which I think we probably all agree to that as we become trauma-informed. And so our focus is on the autonomic nervous system. And what we just did when you were feeling your heart rate change is you were tracking your autonomic nervous system. We have an accelerator and we have a brake. And that accelerator is called the sympathetic, and that's when your heartbeat starts beating a little bit faster. And what do you notice with your kids when you teach them about this, Susie? What do the kids say when you start tracking?
A lot of times when I'm teaching kids about the flow zone and about their sympathetic and their parasympathetic nervous system, we use an analogy of a baseball game and what it feels like for them when they're about to go up to bat. And they immediately pick up on all the cues that our body automatically does. You know, the handle cup. My mouth gets dry. My heart starts feeling it's going to jump right out of my chest because everybody's looking at me. And then we use the analogy of they get on base. They all say they want to hit a triple. So they get a triple, you know. And we talk about that feeling when they're right up there on the edge and they're ready to run home. And then what's the feeling like when they get back in the dugout? And they're like, well, I kind of feel hungry. I want to eat some sunflower seeds, or I want to, I feel my heart kind of come down. I feel a smile on my face. So they're able to notice that this is a normal rhythm that happens all day long, every day. We talk about getting up in front of the class to speak or to share something, how their heart beats. So it's really normalizing this accelerator and this brake that happens every day, all day long, from when we wake up to when we fall asleep.
And it also helps them understand about the resiliency that they have within their nervous system, but it also lays the groundwork of them being able to distinguish and tell the difference between sensations that are connected to trauma and distress or discomfort, that there's also something else going on inside of their nervous system. Because when Janine was talking about the three parts of the brain, and I'm going to tell you something that we've learned, like we don't call it the reptilian brain, we call it the survival brain. Because we work with a lot of faith-based organizations, and there are some people, you know, that very strongly believe in creationism and not in evolution. So we find if we just take that term out and just say survival brain, everybody agrees that there's a survival brain, whether or not we don't have to talk about what the ideology or the theories are. So we've learned by working with large groups of people from many different faiths how to talk about the languaging also to make it more accessible. So that little example of the baseball game and being in front of the classroom is the way that we help children learn how to do those tracking. And Susan said about the laws of nature. Do we have a beautiful sunny day in Southern California today? Yeah. Do you hear what's coming tomorrow? They told us it's going to be raining, right? And so we talk with kids and with adults about the environments that exist outside, but those same environments exist within our nervous system. And when we start paying attention to those sensations connected to our well-being, do you think those are going to expand or contract? What do you think? I'm just throwing that out to all of you. You think that's going to get stronger or go away? What do you think? It gets stronger. And so we actually, with intention, if we bring our attention to sensations of well-being, it actually grows inside of us, just like when we plant a seed and we nurture the ground really well, that it can grow into a beautiful plant. So we use a lot of metaphors that also are connected to nature to help children and adults understand the nervous system. I also want you to know that I work around the world. So I've worked in Haiti in places where people haven't had the advantages of having education. And so you don't have to be able to read or write to track your nervous system. And that's why we can work with very, very small children also, as well as adults. So we've already talked about that. And we also use the word, some people who work with the body use the word somatic. Somatic is a very cultured word, and many people that we work with have not a clue what that means. But we say biology, because one of the things we're trying to do as well is make a very big paradigm shift. And Ruth talked about that this morning, that it's not about mental weakness. It's not that you're bad. It's that you have a biological reaction to events that happen in your life that we all have. And so that is one of our great missions, is to move people out of this idea of pathological to biological. Basically, the idea is to bring the body, mind, and spirit back into balance. And you don't have to talk about the past. And this may also be a paradigm shift, because, Ruth, I'm going to say something, that we believe that you don't have to talk about the narrative, because some people don't want to tell us about their trauma story. But what we found is that you can learn to track your nervous system and in the present moment experience the resiliency and the well-being in your nervous system that makes the narrative not as important. And that really is sometimes like, because I'm also a licensed clinical social worker and a trauma therapist, that my life has been hearing trauma stories. And it's not that we don't want to hear them if the person wants to tell them, but it's very different when we say, you can tell us as little or as much as you want about the story. Sometimes people will start to cry in relief because we have seen where healing doesn't have to come by working through the story, which is also a paradigm shift. I've already talked about how it's useful in different cultures and also consistent among different ages. And again, when we're talking about interventions, many of the Western approaches to healing trauma have, you know, they're designed for children, they're designed for adults. But we've seen that we can design things and also interweave our skills into other kinds of modalities that can help to stabilize the nervous system. So, Susie, you want to talk about what you do with the kids and with parents at school?
Yes. One of the things that I loved when I first started training with Elaine was how concrete and tangible. So I believe that each one of you is going to be able to walk away today with a sense of something that you can do within your community, within your own home, within your children. The six skills that we use here are resourcing, tracking, shift and stay, there's the grounding, and we're going to go through some of those different exercises where you can actually experience that sensation shift within your own nervous system. Everything is happening within the body. It's about learning to tune into and attend to that body, and I am amazed at how well children can learn this skill. We're going to learn resourcing in a little bit, and just to tell you a story, I have a four-year-old that I'm working with. And part of what she was creating with her resource, a resource is what I call a smile inside, something that you can bring to your mind, and it brings you, we never say calm or safe, but you can say calmer or safer. There's the on that. It's a sense of moving towards. And this little four-year-old had talked to me about how she loved Christmas carols, and she would just listen to Christmas carols. And so we had processed, we'll do that in a little bit, about what it means to intensify a resource and really make it something where you tangibly feel it within your body. And so we had done that with her, and we're not talking about resourcing at this time because I'm a play therapist as well, and we're building in the room. And this is a little child who has a lot of anxiety, and when she doesn't like what's happening, she takes the blocks and she chucks them across the room. And so introducing trim skills to her was working on her regulatory, staying within her flow zone. And she's building, and these things aren't working quite so well. And all of a sudden, I'm tracking her body, which we'll learn about tracking in a second as well, and I'm watching it tighten up through here, and I'm just ready to dodge the flying brick. And all of a sudden, she looks up at me, and she goes, fa-la-la-la-la, la-la-la-la. And I notice this big breath she takes, and you watch this expansion come across the chest, and the grin on her face. I didn't need to regulate her. Right? I had given her this skill to say, where can I find something inside that's safer or calmer? And I bring it to my mind and it creates that smile on the outside. And then you watch the parasympathetic nervous system, that break kick in. And the sense of competence that comes within that child is amazing. So all of these things, we're going to go through tracking, resourcing, and a wonderful grounding exercise that I love. Oh, and one of the things, can I bring up iChill app right now? It's a great app if you have a smartphone. It's called iChill, and it goes through all six of these skills, and it will talk you through it. It reads them to you. It reminds you of what to do to build your resource to track. So if you're having a stressful day, open up that app and walk through it, and you'll discover that smile inside you as well. We all have that. It's learning how to, like Elaine was saying, expand that resource.
And it's free. And it's free. It is free. It's called iChill, and also we're in the process of having it translated into Spanish, so we'll also have the iChill in Spanish as well, hopefully within the next few months. But also, you know, we believe in, because we teach, we share these skills with so many parents and children, is that the parents, of course, are the tuning fork for their children. So it's so important for parents to be able to distinguish when they're in their resilient zone or when they're not.
And so a lot of what we do when we're working with adults, with children, is we're really working with the adults. We're working with both. Because when we found that there can be a common language, so if a child says, oh, I'm in my high zone. It's not about it being something that's negative or bad. It's just talking about what happens in the nervous system because something got triggered and the child may be upset. So that's also part of how we change this from being a model of well-being and not a model of pathology. So basically, here's our resilient zone. It's very similar to the window of tolerance that Janina talked about. And this is really our vitality. It's our life force. And we can be in our resilient zone. Notice that they're like, I love roller coasters. But I'm in my resilient zone when I'm on a roller coaster, but I'm on the top end of the resilient zone. And I'm sure some people in this room like to pray or meditate. And you may be in the lower, the parasympathetic response in the resilient zone. So this is our life force. And we know that it's a very important thing that we also learn what are the sensations, but also what are some of the emotions that are connected to these to the resilient zone. Do you want to talk about this one?
So in the idea of it being a biology model rather than a pathology model, part of the most important thing, and Janina said it this morning, is to be able to say, that makes sense. When a child can say, that makes sense, it's amazing. So we don't use the terms, you lost it, or you're acting out. It's a sense of getting bumped out. Everybody gets bumped out sometimes. So you either get bumped out high, and I would show the kids up there, or bumped out low, and kids immediately respond to that sensation. And in this moment, we can use a lot of the tracking language, which is the language of sensation rather than the language of abstract emotion, like angry or sad. We use, you know, red was flashing in my head, or I felt cold and heavy in my stomach, and they learn to get really connected to their body. And I've had, when I teach a health and personal development class to fifth graders, so all of the fifth graders get a full trim training as they go throughout their day, and I usually use analogy of a bad ref, because a bad ref will bump kids out of their resilient zone more than anything. So we were sitting in the class the other day, and I said, it was soccer season, so I said, how many of you guys have been on the soccer field with a bad ref? And I'm tracking all of them. And these bodies get tight and these hands go up. And I said, oh, you all want to tell me a story. I don't want to hear any stories right now. I want you to notice what's happening in your body. And they all, like, their eyes kind of go up inside their head and they're kind of looking around. And then one of them raises their hands and is like, my hands are in fists. Someone says, my heart is beating really fast. Someone's like, my legs are super tight. And you watch this like light bulb dawn in these kids. And I said, and tell me what's going to happen if when you notice that, you don't tell yourself it makes sense. You just keep flying up through here. They're like, you're going to get a red card. I'm like, absolutely. Because even though it makes sense, when you bump out of that zone, who gets blamed? We do. So I said, so what if we learned how when you noticed all that, you're able to say, that makes sense. Everybody should be mad at a bad ref. No wonder my hands are like this. What can I do right now to be able to stay in my flow zone and learning that experience? But I'm telling you, they get this picture so much. I have a little boy, and I knew he was struggling in my class, but he is listening to this with his eyes this big. And I said, can you tell me some sensations when you get bumped out of the top of your flow zone? And kids are saying, you want to yell, I want to punch somebody, I want to scream. And he raised his hand, and dead serious, he says, that's when I want to kill myself. And this is a kid, and fortunately, thank God, the whole class was just kind of like there to hold him, because it was that moment that it was just very genuine. Like, and what was neat is that he was able to recognize, that's not really me. That's the feeling I get when I'm out of my flow zone. So if I can learn how to stay in my flow zone, I won't have those desires anymore. And that was really exciting that he was willing to say, I want to work to learn how to stay here because that's not what I really want to do.
And Susie, and tell them what the other children did. So it wasn't like something then that was a negative. It was like then the other children could come in and say what they said.
They were all just kind of like nodding their head. And they were like, we get that. Like those are what big feelings are like. To be able to own our big feelings and not pathologize them is really, really powerful.
Every time I've been doing a lot of work in Washington, D.C., and I've been staying with a family, and their two children can be very lively. And so I was saying one day, well, you want me to come, you know, half an hour, you know, like a day earlier, and I can share with the family all this information. So I did, and I got a little card a couple weeks later from actually the mother and the daughter who was 11 at the time. And so they told me a story that her mom came home from work. She works at Walter Reed Hospital, and she was really out. She was in her high zone. And so the little girl walks in, and she was in her resilient zone. She said, "Mom, do you think you're in your high zone or your resilient zone today?" And the mom looked at her. She goes, she goes, "I am so in my high zone." So the little girl said, "Well, Mommy, what if we just did one of our skills today, and maybe we could both be in our resilient zone?" And so they both stopped. They laughed. And after they laughed, she was totally in her resilient zone. But there you go, using the language that, you know, think about other paradigms or things that have happened. Mom's stressed. Kid comes in. "What are you doing? Why aren't you helping me?" But instead, the family was using this language of the nervous system. You know, I'm not going to go through all the symptoms on all these, because I think Janina did a really good job of doing that. But I think it's really important that when we apply it to children, and sometimes I hate the word regressive behaviors, because it's to me there's a certain pathology about it, because it's when children are acting younger than their age, because, and they may be in the high zone or low zone because of the stress happening in their life. So I really will hopefully challenge every single one of us here in the room to really be careful about our languaging when we're trying to describe reactions, really common reactions that children and adults may have as a result of trauma. So this next slide really talks about some in a very simple way, and I want to go over this because it's some of what Janina said today. After a traumatic event, some adults and children will always be afraid, even when there's no threat. Even a small stressor can cause an adult and child to be afraid. And the reason why we want people to learn about these different sensations and to tell the difference, because the same sensations that are connected to maybe running fast on the field is about the sympathetic nervous system, the heart beating fast, the breathing being faster and shallower. And can you see that there can be something that we call coupling? So the child's out on the playground, he's running, and all of a sudden he feels a sense of fear and dread because he is responding to the trigger of his nervous system. So when we help them understand that connection, like Susan said, then they can start to differentiate and say, "No, that's just because I'm running fast. That's not because I'm right now in danger." Because I think there's a, I kind of really want to emphasize this point. I have come to believe that you can't use the prefrontal cortex to tell the survival brain what to do. Because if you're in your survival brain, like Janina said, it is about survival. It's about life and death. So if you say stop it, your heartbeat is still going fast. Your breathing is still going fast. And so we have to use the language of sensation to help children and adults get back into their resilient zone. So this, our model is not a cognitive model. It is a bottom-up approach. And I liked what you said, Ruth, about the timeout and some of the things that we've done. And so if a child is having an angry outburst and we say, "Stop it, go to the corner." Well, is that changing the inner experience of the child? But if we say, "You know, there's a lot of energy in your system. Hey, Susan, why don't we do it together? Let's push against the wall together. And let's see, notice the noises that you're making. And how about your legs and your arms? All right." I took a breath. Did you take a breath?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I feel better. Oh, well,
okay,
well, let's go back and maybe we can make dinner together, okay? So there you're doing something in a very, a non-pejorative way in working with your knowledge about the nervous system to help regulate the nervous system. And, you know, some of the work that we do also, I want to, kind of pay credit. It's like when you create something, you stand on the shoulders of other people who have come before. I have borrowed a lot of the work of occupational therapists in terms of these exercises that help regulate the nervous system. So we've done a constellation of how we can help not only children, but adults, but parents can do the same thing. "Oh, I'm bumped out of my resilient zone. You want to help me push against the wall and maybe I'll feel better." And that's the languaging that we're talking about. Okay. You're going to do this one.
Yes. So just really quickly, I wanted to just go through some of the language that I've written down that I've collected over the years for asking kids about their different zones. I kind of label it between a 1 and a 10. So 1 to 3 is kind of being in your low zone. 4 to 7 is being within your flow zone. And then 8 through 10 is when you're more highly activated. And so children need you to be able to be cognizant when our frontal lobe is working requires that capacity to connect internally. I always want kids to be able to say, with curiosity, it's my favorite word, oh, it's okay, my body is telling me something, how do I listen? And so teaching kids how to listen respectfully to their body so that when they notice it, it's an ability to notice without judgment. That is something I love so much about this model. My body's doing what it's supposed to do right now. It's keeping me safe. It's telling me you might need to be ready to run. One quick story. I had a little girl who was coming home from a soccer tournament. She was a defender, and she had been passed up by a forward, and a goal had been scored in the last 30 seconds, thus them losing 1-0. So she told me, she goes, I came home, and I was going to do two things, and one was in her high zone, and one was in her low zone. She goes, I was going to either say, soccer is stupid, it's the dumbest sport ever, I'm quitting, I'm never playing soccer again, or I was going to get into bed and cover up and never get out ever again. So she said, I said, aha, my body is telling me something. So I'm going to sit down. So she said, she sat down. She goes, I put my feet in the ground. We're going to talk about grounding like a tree. And she goes, what is this I'm noticing? And she's the cutest little thing. She always wears this little bow right on top of her head. She's 11 years old. And she goes, and I found it, and it was all over my body. And it was green and jumpy. And it says, I am disappointment. And she says, as I sat there, disappointment took form, and it jumped on my lap like a cat. And I was a little surprised, so I just started petting it. And she goes, you know how cats are? After a little while, it was done being petted, and it just jumped off. And she said she noticed, you know, the sense, and she goes, and all of a sudden, I was noticing my body now, and it was telling me, I'm hungry. So I got up out of my room, and I went out, and I had lunch with my family. And to be able to watch that happen is unreal. It's that ability to say, I don't have to bump up here or bump down there. I can notice it with such respect. And when it's done telling me what it needs to tell me, it will move on. And so just being able to ask them these kind of questions, I'll just read a little bit about some of the notes that I've taken. When I ask kids what it's like to be in the resilient zone, they will say, oh, where do I have it? I don't know that I took notes on this one. Usually they just say, I feel open through my chest. My arms and legs are kind of tingly. I have a sense of calm in my tummy. It's like I'm sitting on the beach, they'll say. Or it's like I'm climbing in my treehouse and I can see everybody, but nobody can see me. So there's a lot of sense of being able to see clearly, a lot of sense of expansiveness. When they talk to me, these are things they have told me about. What does it look like and sound like? These are important questions. And we're gonna do a tracking exercise in a minute. This is not how do you feel. Feel becomes a very cognitive, angry, mad, sad, these kind of things, which are very abstract. How do you feel? And I'll keep after them until they say, okay, I feel like a swirling blue butterfly-like thing jumping up and down in my tummy. Ah, there you are. And then they're really aware of sensations. So these are things that they say when it's in their high zone. Racing, blood is pounding in my ears. Everything is black. I see red. It's squeezed so tight in here like someone with a giant hand is squeezing me. My body is tight. And then when with the what it looks like and sounds like in the low zone, it says, it sounds like an empty hole. It sounds like crying. My arms and legs are heavy. It's like being in a gray fog. I don't want to talk. I feel shivery and cold. So being able to understand that language, and for adults as well, if we could imagine if we could communicate in that type of language, rather, because my mad's going to look different than your mad, but I say, you know, remember when your blood starts pounding in your ears? You know, it's like, yeah, that sensation.
Well, and I think the other thing that's important about what Susan's saying is that when people do give us a feeling like mad, angry, sad, we'll say, well, what are you noticing on the inside as you say those words? So we're always linking the sensation with the feeling. And the other part about it is that wonderful little story about the girl that she actually changed the meaning of her experience. She was able to process it, think differently about it, and then go be with her family. So imagine if we had a lot of children that could do that. What would that do with the shame that we sometimes feel when we disappoint ourselves? And that if we get stuck there, and then maybe other people reinforce it. And what we see over and over again is that people, as people are able to
begin to sense their well-being, to track those differences, that they start saying the most amazing statements of well-being and shifting from shame to actually self-appreciation and gratitude. And I think that's one of the striking things for all of us that do this work. I want to move, so Susie just did, we have the tracking. We're going to just go through this because we're going to just go right to the tracking exercise because she's already talked about it. And so you notice that you have some apples in front of you. And this is the raisin fruit exercise. I mean, you can really do this with almost anything. And so, Dahlia, can you help us? So some people came in. We have plates of apples on some of the tables. And yeah, each person gets one. So I'm going to ask you, I'm going to invite you to take a piece of apple in your hand. And
tell kids when we do this exercise, when we're eating with a very big awareness or mindfully eating, you don't have to actually eat it, but you can still do all the other things. So if you don't like apples,
don't eat it.
Can still do all the rest of the stuff.
So you can touch it if you'd like, and then as you touch it, just notice the kinds of the sensations. Is it sticky? Is it scratchy? Is it rough? Is it smooth? So take it. No, thank you. I get to not do it. I've already done it. Okay. And then as you look at it, you know, what is it that happens on the inside? If you like apples, you could notice you start to salivate. Anybody salivating as they're looking at that? Oh, look at, we've got some salivators over here. Okay. And so then I'm going to invite you as well to bring it to your nose and smell it. Oh, I see a friend of mine, Joel. He's already eaten it. Joel, we didn't even get to that point there. So if you do want to take a bite, and that's up to you if you'd like to do that or not, like Susan said, is it juicy? Is it tasty? Is it sweet? Is it sour? And as you take a bite, what do you notice on the inside? So Joel, I'm going to pick on you now. What did you notice on the inside? You start to slow down. And so when you say slowing down, what happens to your heart rate and to your breathing? It's speeding up because that happened. But look at how well he was able to tell the difference between his nervous system speeding up or slowing down. And so this is one of the exercises, and there's many that we can use with learning how to track sensations. Anything more, Susan, that you want to say?
Students, is that I will play music. Because music is very inviting of different sensations happen inside of us. So I'm going to play just about 10 seconds of a song that I use with my fifth graders. And I would like you to notice two things. One, sometimes memories come into your mind. Your narrative may come into your mind. So I usually, when I do this in my class, if you guys work with kids or want to, or you work with adults, it can be helpful to draw. I have them draw a line down the center of the paper. And on one side, I have them write down, what is your brain telling you about this song? And then on the other side, I said, what is your body experiencing about this song? And usually I play it for them twice and let them tell stories or memories or things that their brain is telling them on one side. And then we listen to it again. And I said, now we're just going to use the language of sensation. So like if you look at your slide, twitchy, dull, sharp, thick, vibrating, numb, expanding, tight, puffy, colors, shapes, textures, whatever it is. So we're going to do both at once because we don't have enough time to go through the song twice. But I'm going to play it for you, and I'd like you to, when you notice that your brain is doing the brain thing and you're bringing up memories, see if you can shift and just go through your body. Let your eyes be like a flashlight of attention and just move through your body. And then I'm going to give you maybe a minute to share at your tables what you notice. All right, here it comes.
Thank you.
see, where do you notice those sensations in your body? And then take a moment to share at your table. And again, pleasant, unpleasant, neutral sensations, whatever they are, notice what they are and just see if you can speak. This is practice. You're going to notice that sometimes using sensory language is not our first option. So I want you to practice using sensory terms. So go ahead, you have about a minute. So I'm wondering if you guys could give me some of your sensory-based language that you used to describe what it was like listening to that song.
Go ahead and just shout it out. Exciting. Okay.
Where was the excitement in your body? In your face. You were smiling. You noticed the smiling. And in your shoulders. Yes. So exciting, again, is one of those words that I want to translate into where you notice in your body, because that's where we get the expansion of the well-being. That's where we get, as long as it's a positive term, that's what we want, you know, a positive sensation. We want to expand it. So that sense, once even just now that you noticed yourself doing those shoulders, to tell me what happened to the sensation of exciting. Yes. Right. So, you know, before long, this whole thing happens. And I watch that with the kids in my classroom. Initially, they're kind of thinking about the song. And then when I ask them to notice the sensation, they're like, my feet want to tap, tap, tap. And I said, just notice what your body wants to do. And it's delightful. I love delightfulness. What else? Any other good sensory words? Let's hear some good sensory words. Okay.
Anticipation, she said.
Okay, and where do you notice the anticipation in your body?
In your feet.
Yes.
And her feet are moving right now.
And okay, I'm going to go a little further because this is how I'd work with kids. Does it have a color or a shape or a texture? What do you notice with that in your feet? Kind of red and yellow in your feet. Is it still or is it moving? It's moving. It's red and yellow moving in your feet. That is beautiful. Take one more.
Pumped up.
And I notice that is in your arms, so pumped up in your arms. Pumped. So where, all through your body, your whole body, does it have a color or a shape or a texture? Okay. What about, was there any kind of, how would you describe it in good sensory terms for that pumped up? Sometimes we use vibrating or shimmering or...
It was a vibration.
It was a vibration. Yeah, a vibration. And your body tells it. I mean, you really don't need to use words. This just kind of gives it all to us.
And we're going to move into the resourcing now because we want to at least teach you three of the basic skills. So the second one is resourcing. And resourcing are just the person, places, activities, pets, it could be your faith, things that can give you joy, pleasure, or calm. It's really important with resourcing that it's not just calm. Sometimes people think, oh, it's just to get into that zone like a Buddha state. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking again about the vitality. So when we're working with children, we might actually ask them that if they can tell us about something, like you say, that can make them feel that smile on the inside. So we try to use languaging that is more appropriate to their developmental age, depending on the age of the child. It can be real or imagined. For some children, their resource may be a superhero. It may be you. It may be your relationship with the child. And we ask them to tell us about their resource. That's one way, a narrative about their resource. But some children, it's harder for them to talk about their resource, and I use this a lot when I go into disaster areas, is we draw pictures of the resource. And this is something that we actually don't draw a picture of the trauma. We draw a picture of the resource because the trauma is all around them, and oftentimes in disaster areas, people forget that they have resources. And we have had just amazing experience with children as they've highlighted their resources and then share them with a friend. And then we know that they can use that resource when we leave those disaster areas. And we just did this in the Philippines, and it was something that was really important to them because one of the things they found, because a lot of Westerners go into disaster areas like after the typhoon, and they bring in models that are really trauma-based. And when you leave someone in the trauma state without shifting their awareness to what was also their resiliency and well-being, it actually can cause more disturbance. So working with resourcing this way is very important. So what we're going to invite you to do right now is we'd like you to identify some of your resources. And you have a handout in your packet that we're going to ask you to write down three resources. And I'm going to give you the instruction, and if you don't want to use the handout, you can just write it in the back of the paper. But write down three of your resources, and then circle one, and write down three or more details about your resource. And then you're going to read your resource to yourself, and as you read the resource to yourself, you're going to pay attention to what you notice happening on the inside. And that means noticing your breathing, your heart rate, your muscle relaxation. You know, to give you an example, do you need a handout over here? It's coming. Is that one of my resources is my grandmother. Her name was Eva. I used to call her Abuelita Linda. My mother and grandmother were from El Salvador. And she was just wonderful. Of course, she died a few years ago. And when I think about her, can you notice what's happening to me right now as I'm talking about her? I'm smiling. And does anybody want to ask me what I'm noticing on the inside as I'm thinking about her? I'm taking a deep breath, and I feel warmth. And I'm thinking about how she used to make pancakes for me that looked like Mickey Mouse. And she used to cuddle me in her big brown eyes and make me feel like I was safer. Because I, like many of you, grew up in another household that wasn't very safe. And so that she was such an amazing resource. And I'm now tingling down my legs as I'm thinking about her. So that's how a resource can be really powerful. And resources also, as you write down your resources, they can have two natures. And sometimes when we write down the resources, and I could go there if I wanted to, I could feel a little wetness of the tears in my eyes because I miss her. And that's okay, because resources, we find that when we focus on the sensations of well-being, like for my grandma, I can hold the sadness of her no longer being here, as well as the joy of what she gave to me in my life. So just take a few moments to write down those instructions, and then I'm going to tell you what we'll do next with it. So take about a minute to finish up, and if you haven't had a chance to do the whole exercise, it's also something that you can do when you leave today, but it's what's really important about writing down your resource. Yes, so it's what's really important when you are working with the resourcing is the three descriptors are called resource intensification. Because if you just say, oh, tell me about your grandmother, but I told you a number of things about my grandmother, it takes a lot to override the negative programming of the amygdala. Because we need to really develop the descriptors, because that expands the sensations of well-being in the body, then can do something so that we don't get triggered all the time. One of the things, I work a lot also with veterans, and one of the things that we've noticed as we've shared these skills is that you can intercept what we call the hijacking of the nervous system. Because when you start being able to notice those differences between sensations of regulation and dysregulation, if all of a sudden I hear something and I feel like this, I can go, wait a second, I can resource, there's my grandma. I take a deep breath, and so then my nervous system goes back into balance. And what we've seen in the projects that we've done, and we don't have time to go into detail about it, but we did a big project in San Bernardino County where they identified 7 at-risk groups for us to bring these skills to. We did pre- and post-tests, and we looked at them 3 to 6 months later. We just finished the project in December of 2013. We had statistically significant reductions in depression, anxiety, somatic indicators, and most importantly, from what we're talking about here, hostility indicators. And so what we believe, if we can get into our resilient zone, and we have very simple strategies to do this, I believe that Ruth's call to action about ending violence in our world is really possible. But if we are bumped out into our high zone and our low zone, we do not have the best capacity of thinking, of feeling, of being able to find those solutions for our life. So I really encourage you to really think about, and not only think, but to sense into your resources. So I'm wondering if there's anyone that would share with me the resource they wrote down. Okay, thank you, Piggy. Okay, so, just the one you chose.
Sage.
Sage. And can you tell me a little bit about Sage?
And just as I wrote it, interesting was I could smell it already burning.
You could, and you're doing this, with your hands.
That's what I would do with the sage, would be bring it there.
Could you slow down your hands just a little bit? Just notice what happens as you remember.
I can actually
I just
feel the pain, and I can also then feel my body, the inside of my body settles down. My heart rate slows down. My stomach feels calm. My abdomen has chills all over
Wow.
me. Wow. It feels very comforting to me. The whole belly thing.
Well, so just notice all those sensations of comfort and to know that you can use that again. Now, they were at my training at Peace Over Violence, so I guess that's a little bit unfair. They've already had an experience of that. But that's right. So this is something she practices. And just like anything, like a muscle, it gets stronger the more that you work the muscle, which is one of the reasons why we have the iChill app, because the more that people listen to it, we have heard, the stronger they get in being able to really get into their resilient zone. Okay, we're going to go to grounding right now because we want to get that last one in.
I think so. You will have this in your handout. So if you're wanting to work on helping a child with their resourcing, you have some language. I always like walking away from a conference with some language that I can use with my kids. So we're going to talk about grounding and sensing your body in the present moment. This is significant because if we can get ourselves feeling, I'm right here, right now. I'm not in the place that caused this trigger of this trauma. I'm right here, right now. So I'm going to get all of you guys to stand up. Do you want to move on to the next one? This is one of my favorites. I do this with all my second graders. Second grade, as I found, is a little tough year at the school. The girls start stealing each other's friends, which is very traumatic. I always wonder if they put them in a trunk in a car and drive off somewhere. But, you know, she stole my friend. I'm not allowed to play with her anymore. So they have a lot of growing up happens right around 7 and 8, and then the things developmentally that they learn. So teaching them, I go into the classrooms and we do all kinds of really fun exercises to help them say, I am enough. I am here. I am who I am, and I am rooted. So we're going to just walk through this one together, and I really encourage you to keep thinking about the sensory language we've been using. If I could change a paradigm, it would be from moving from our thinking heads to really letting our bodies just inform us. We have so much information that comes with our bodies. So I'm going to treat you like a 7-year-old, sorry. Can you stand like you are a tree? So I want you to feel yourself. You are a tree. You can be any kind of tree you like. You can be a willow tree, a pine tree. You can be a big old oak tree, whatever tree feels right for you, a fruit tree if you want to be. And I'm going to ask you to really slowly rock forward till you feel all your toes on the ground just a little bit. And then move backwards till you feel your heel really in the ground. And at your own speed, whatever feels good, move forward on your toes. And slowly back on your heels. I want you to see if you can feel every piece of your foot connected to the ground. And then after we've rocked about 3 times, find yourself centered on the ground and give your knees just a little slight bend. And now, I want you to think about roots growing right out of the bottom of your feet. Roots are what hold you. They provide you nutrition. They keep your tree strong and vibrant and green. So I want you to feel that. You might even notice some tingling. You might notice some warmth. This is your roots saying, I am here. I am enough. I am strong. And then I want you to say, when I have those roots, stuff can happen to me in life. So I want your branches to come up, however your branches want to come up. And then I want you to notice that life isn't still. Life moves. So I want you to, it's a gentle breeze today. It's just a nice spring day in Southern California. So feel those roots in the ground, but I want you to feel the breeze blow. Feel what it feels like to be anchored down on the ground, knees slightly bent, roots solid, and that breeze just blowing you. What if that breeze gets a little stronger? Feel it. It's a windy day. Today's not as good, but your feet are right there. You might need to bend your knees just a little bit. You want to feel those roots sinking in, and the wind's coming, and you said, I am enough. I am here. I am strong. And the wind's going to die down a little bit, and I want you to end in that strong tree posture that you were in. Branches, however you like them, whatever feels right. Feel those roots solid. Feel the trunk solid. And feel those branches just moving a little bit in the breeze. And I want you to notice just what it feels like to be right here, right now. And when you're ready, you can bring your branches down and you can find a seat. But after I would do that with the children, I would ask them to tell me what it felt like to be that tree. and get such great comments from the kids. They're like, nothing can blow me over. you know, there's that sense. They almost always say, I can feel the roots. They're coming out. Could any of you feel the tingling sensation of roots actually growing out of your feet? It's an amazing thing when we take that flashlight of attention and shine it on a body part. They've done studies that show if you imagine your hand in a glove and you have, you know, I forget what it's called when your hands aren't cold, your hand will heat up. You can actually do that just by thinking. And so their sensations of the roots growing out, they love it. And kids have come back saying, when I had to get a shot at the doctor's, I pushed my feet in the ground and I felt my roots grow, and then the shot was over. So that sense of being right there with themselves, supporting themselves, it's just beautiful to watch.
Every time you talk, I think your students are so lucky to have you. Don't you? Oh, my. Anyway, one of the things about the order of how we're teaching this is that we used to teach grounding before we taught resourcing, and when we've done a lot of work in the community, we found that it wasn't a good idea, because oftentimes people will need an image. That's why we can ground with the tree exercise or start with resourcing, because of implicit memory that Janina talked about. Implicit memory, think about, like, we have memory capsules of implicit memory, like my grandmother or some of the resources that you've had, but we also have implicit memory of the negative things that have happened to us, memory capsules that cause dysregulation. So if we sometimes start to sense our body without an image, it can send us into a traumatic flashback. So the order of how we do this is very important in terms of helping children and adults be able to sense into their well-being and their resilience. Okay, so this is going to be our end because we're at 3 minutes. See, and we already did the help now strategies when we pushed against the wall. But this is a new skill that we just recently added as a skill. As I think we really did our work in San Bernardino and in Haiti. But what we've learned is every single one of us has a gesture of self-healing and self-soothing that's not self-harming. And I'm going to invite you for just a second to think about if there's a gesture that you make, and usually gestures are right underneath consciousness, but a gesture that you make that actually helps comfort you. I'm going to tell you what mine is, and Susie, you would like to share yours too. Mine's this. Imelda, I think yours is this. but it's this, and I didn't know that I did this. And now that I know it, sometimes I'm like in contentious board meetings or something, and I'm feeling getting a little bumped out of into my high zone, and I'm just underneath the table going, no, I'm fine. You know, and I'm just doing this little gesture. My husband does this, which is not comforting to me, but it's comforting to him. And when he does it, I know that I probably said something to disturb him. So go ahead, Susie, what is yours?
I don't know why I do this, but I rotate my wrists, and I've had my kids will always do that. Or I do like this, and my kids are like, oh, Mom, they call it beaking, just my mouth usually goes, so I look like I have a little beak. Mom's beaking. She's excited about something. So it's a gesture that kind of, this one's more of my calming gesture. It's just a wrist rotation. I don't know why, but I'll do this when I'm just kind of wanting to see. This is kind of like, all right, we're off and running. Here we go.
Okay, so I'm gonna count to three. And at three, I would invite everyone to do their self-soothing gesture if they know it. Okay, one, two, three. And you can look around the room because you'll see people doing all sorts of different things, which I just love, the uniqueness of us. Yeah, okay. And notice what happens on the inside when you do your self-soothing gesture. Like, what do you notice, Allison? What happens on the inside when you make that movement?
It gets bigger.
More expansive. Just like the children in your class. And that happens when you take a deeper breath and you access the parasympathetic nerve. Oh, and I love yawns. Yay! Yawning is a release sensation. And we often see, it's the best, right? So we're going, all right, yawns.
2 minutes at least.
That's right. Yawns are, it's actually is one of those natural things that regulates the nervous system. So to end, since we have 1 minute now, I love to end this. This is like a new thing about gesturing, and it's wonderful to do with kids, isn't it? So I'm going to invite us all to stand again. And to think about a gesture of joy, of this particular to you, a gesture of joy. Just think for a few seconds. And on the count of three, I'm going to invite you all to make that gesture. And then to notice what happens on the inside and then notice the room. So one, two, three. Yes. And notice, look around the room and notice everyone else. Notice the smiles and the posture. And notice what happens inside of you, not only when you make your own gesture, but when you see everybody else's. Ooh, I love that. All right. So to end, this is why we call it the community resiliency model. Because what we've seen is that when we get into our resilient zone, it is infectious. We know that has to do with mirror neurons that we get a lot of information about these days. And so the more that we can stay in our resilient zone and help others around us be in it, then we have seen, and also we now have through research, that people feel better. Less anxiety, less depression, less hostility indicators. And I'm going to leave with the words of Mrs. Harris, who's one of our community resiliency model skills trainers from San Bernardino. She's African American, and she said, we had a conference there as part of the project, and she said, Elaine and everyone here, my hope is that if a young man pulls out a gun, that somebody in the community, that everybody will be trained, that they'll go, hey man, ground yourself. That's intercepting the hijacking. And that was a very profound statement for me that she shared with all of us. So with that, thank you so much for having us. Thank you.